pleasure to introduce this morning's plenary speaker, Professor Matilde Marcolli from Bonn. Her initial work was in the geometry of gauge fields, specifically on cyber-Witten theory, which was also the subject of her first book, published in 1999. And subsequently, she moved on via index theory on orbifolds into the realm of non-commutative geometry, where she has become the driving force between the recent interaction between non-commutative geometry and number theory, or more generally, arithmetic algebraic geometry. And this is the subject of another book of hers written together with Alain Combe, called Non-Commutative Geometry, Quantum Fields and Motives, which is truly amazing in its scope and depth. It ranges from the standard model of elementary particle physics through the theory of motives and Adele's and the Riemann hypothesis into quantum gravity. And as such, I'd say it could only have been written by either crackpots or geniuses. But Matilde won the Kowalewskaya Award of the German government for young foreign scientists, which is rarely awarded to crackpots. Now, there's another side to this which I'd like to mention, and which is obvious if you look around you in the audience. I'll make the point by an anecdote, which is as follows. There was a professor at my current university who's now retired, and who used to start all his lectures by saying, "Good morning, gentlemen." Although, even at the time, about a third of the students were female. And so after a while, the male students began to complain to him, saying, "Well, here, there are about 10 women in the audience at each of your lectures." But he insisted in saying, "Good morning, gentlemen," at each and every lecture. And so, to make a point, the male students decided not to show up for one of his lectures to see how he would respond. And indeed, he looked around and, he didn't say, "Good morning, gentlemen." So what he said instead is, "Well, I noticed no one has shown up today, so let's cancel the lecture." So, Matilde's title is Renormalization, Galois Connections, and Motives. Please.
Okay. Can you hear me all right? Okay. So, what I'm planning to do is to give a sort of general overview on different approaches to a somewhat strange interplay, which is not completely understood at present, between two very, very different subjects, one coming from quantum physics, and specifically quantum field theory, which is a theory of renormalization, which is kind of a recipe that physicists use to eliminate infinities and divergences in their calculation and come up with finite results that can be compared to experiment. And on the other hand, some rather abstract mathematics, which is the theory of motives in algebraic geometry. It's kind of a refinement of algebraic varieties and a way, kind of universal cohomology theory for algebraic varieties, and symmetries of this object in the form of some Galois, some extension of Galois theory. So, I mean, this is, in a sense, a seemingly strange match of subjects. So, to get an example, what you have on the one hand is some kind of integrals that are constructed starting from a combinatorial information of a graph. This is what people do in quantum field theory. They have some kind of expansions in terms of Feynman graphs, and to each graph they associate certain integrals that they compute. And these integrals have the bad habit of being most of the time divergent, and that's where the problem of renormalization comes in. So it seems to be a problem which is by itself a sort of analytic and partly combinatorial nature. And on the other hand, you have this other subject, which is the theory of motives, which is a way to embed the category of algebraic varieties into a category that has nicer properties, namely, where morphisms behave better, and with morphisms, instead of being given by maps of varieties, they're given by certain correspondence, which are constructed out of algebraic cycles. And it's this way one finds kind of universal cohomology theory that lies behind all the known well-behaved cohomology theories for algebraic varieties. So in this, so what do these things have in common, or why is there any reason to believe that they ought to have something in common? So there is some various sources of supporting evidence for the fact that there are links between these two theories. So the story, in a sense, started out with early computations, a sort of, you know, collection of calculations that physicists, in particular Broadhurst and Kramer, made of, you know, Feynman integrals, these kind of, you know, integrals that physicists compute. And surprisingly, what comes out of these integrals are certain numbers, which are interesting numbers from the mathematical point of view. So they're not algebraic numbers, but they are transcendental numbers, which are of an interesting kind, and that means they are periods. And this is a class of numbers which are particularly interesting in mathematics. And in particular, the kind of numbers they found, for example, are zeta values and multiple zeta values, and so on. So this already pointed to something. You know, when mathematicians start to see interesting numbers coming out, they want to know the reason why that should be the case. And so there are two approaches, and I will try to, you know, outline both of them. So I will distinguish them by calling them a bottom-up approach and a top-down approach to the interplay between these two subjects. The bottom-up approach is that you start from a single graph, you look at the corresponding integral, and you try to construct a corresponding algebraic object, an algebraic variety, and realize this integral as a period on that variety, and then you try to understand what kind of a period is that, and what kind of a motive is the variety, the part of the variety that supports this period.